woke up this morning, what do I see? 3,000 cameras pointed at me. Two says you Levi, I'm like, yes, that's me, sir. Well, you just knocked up the VP nominee's daughter. So I tell him no, you got it wrong, mister. Already got a strap, and her name is Bristol. They all laugh and say, where you been, sonny? Your mother-in-law's a heartbeat from the presidency. And I say, mother-in-law now, they get married.
Thank you.
That was a very dramatic experience for us here on stage. A lot just happened. I just laughed and I cried and I lived a lifetime with you all here in one song. And I'd like to thank you for being a part of that. This next song is in the key of A.
Yeah!
It's called Jump on My Nutsack. Wait a minute, it's actually called Doc Pomus and it's on the new record, and Nick Hornby wrote the words and probably wouldn't appreciate it if I'd renamed his song. Man in a wheelchair, man in the lobby, fighters, hustlers, hard up cops, horse pimps, and nutsacks. All human life was there. Man in a wheelchair listens to the chatter, writes down all the insane crowd he hears. Can't move around, but it doesn't. Far and stall you, meet his eyes there. Record actually, it's my record, but he wrote the lyrics for it. Actually, he gets 50% of the record technically, and so it's mine and Nick's record. So actually, this is a record by Nick Hornby and myself called Lonely Avenue, and this song is on the record. I'm glad I don't have to talk for a little. Actually, one time I did have to talk like that. On a television show. Have you guys seen that Bill Maher show where they argue with each other? Yeah, they don't play it here probably. They play it in the United States. It's a good show. People get on and argue about politics. It's politically incorrect, that's right. And I went on that show one time, and it was the first person that never said anything on the show. And then there was a woman that we know named Jermaine Greer. And she was on the show, and she had said something earlier. The producer came to me and said, "Mr. Folds, please say something, because you don't want to be our first guest in the history of the show not to say anything at all." So when it came back after commercial, then I just tried to take up for Jermaine Greer, because she was being misunderstood a point she was making about female genital mutilation. And I tried to support her. She cut me off. So fuck those talking shows. I never want to.
Every night about this time, she has to sing Belinda. Belinda, I love you. Don't leave me. I need you. You tried to stop a while back, but what is he without her? What he is, and anyway, he always hears how much it means to people. There's a lot of 40-somethings who wouldn't be in the world without him. Now he does it with this lyric in his head.
This next song is a cover song, which means that I didn't write it, and someone else wrote it, and then we're doing it. We couldn't come up with a cover that we all agreed on, and it is a democracy every once in a while in this band. And so since we couldn't come up with anything, I decided, okay, fuck it, we're gonna go on iTunes and find out what's number one at this moment, and we'll do that song. And at the moment, it was a song by Kesha called Sleazy. And that song, it's a good song, and it got knocked off the iTunes charts within the day. So it wasn't, I could have gotten out of it, but I wanted to keep my word. That's what it said at the time that we agreed on this. So we did this song. We've reharmonized it pretty severely, and here's our version of Kesha's song Sleazy.
I don't need you in your brand new Benz or your bougie friends. I don't need love looking like diamonds.
Get Susie.
I'm a guest.
Socks off, so we'll meet the dollars in your Dropbox.
play that one. I just started playing it and freaking out. Sorry. Kind of surreal
The experience was surreal because I'm not a drug taker or anything, but I did have to on this German tour. And it was because I had to take codeine drops, and so I was meandering around on stage. Was really getting very uncomfortable with a German audience staring as I was trying to write a song on stage. And they had they paid lots of geld to see the show, and there I was fucking it up. And anyway, so but what's cool is all of a sudden I broke into this and we played this band. It's mostly there. You can see it on YouTube. It's called Rock This Bitch and Cologne on the YouTube. But I just changed a couple things and turned it into a song. And now I play with symphony orchestras, which I would have never thought was going to happen as I was sitting there meandering on stage, fucked up on coding.
Thank you.
This song is written for the great poet Saskia Hamilton. The song is called "It's Okay, the Baby's Gonna Come Out Very Soon."
The morning sun.
Thank you.
bass and bass roam through the streets and coffee shops. They're prey gathering herbs of stiff kneeling skirts and wide ankle socks. But while they search for a mate, my time hibernate in bedrooms above, composing their songs of love. In uniform lines, in uniform time, in uniform time. Run around in trousers on fire, in signs of desire. They cannot describe the sky.
Showing while you were sleeping, you never once looked. Coffee up on the table like a man in. Oh,
to tell you, it's not gonna come out like I wanna say it, cause I know you'll only change it.
Don't help me.
Some songs I don't normally play, see how that goes.
I
But at the point you start thinking, right before a section, you go, I wonder how that part goes. You're never going to get it. Can't think that. I was running downstairs one time, and I thought, I wonder what's going to happen if I stop putting one foot in front. What the fuck? Okay, I'm sorry. I'm going to have to figure out my own course. This is the biggest I've ever failed in front of an audience. It's the biggest failure I've ever failed. Shit all over my Some summers in the evening after six or so, I walk on down the hill and maybe buy a beer. I think about my friends. Sometimes I wish they'd lived out here, but they wouldn't dig this town. No, they wouldn't dig this town. Try not to think about how this chilled us. Try not to think about it anymore. Try not to think about how this chilled us.
traffic, squatting bare-assed in the dirty rice from a bowl, with a towel on their head or maybe a bone in their nose. See that asshole with the peace sign on his license plate, giving me the finger and running me out of his lane. God made us number one, cause he loves us the best. Well, maybe he better go bless someone else for a while. Give us a rest. Yes, and everyone can see they give no flying fuck. We made it all that we can eat. Get down.
Also by request.
How's a few things? Can't fool me, I saw you when you came out. You got your mama's taste, then you got my mouth. You will always have a part of me. Nobody else is ever gonna see Gracie girl. To your chest, walking on your toes. What you got in the box, only Gracie knows. And I can never try to make you be anything you didn't really want to be, Gracie girl.
Of boyfriends, I had a
were standing out on the sidewalk with eye tattoos and look like rings in the hot for the moment we're alone.
song's about a young lawyer who brings a blind date to a party in America. For those of you who don't live there or don't go there, it's not advisable to talk about politics at parties right now. So this girl came as a blind date and started talking about shit that got her date fired from his job.
Fucking Cheney, and you come back before I songs are, most of my songs are kind of true stories because it's a lot harder to make shit up. And basically, if you take something that happened, this is good advice for songwriters, and tell it to your friends, and then make it rhyme. Then put a melody to it, and make it interesting, and make it not sound like something else that you've heard before, and it could be pretty good. This is a song, I'll tell you the story sort of backwards in a way. I had decided to join the armed forces when I was 17. As you get 18, you can sign up and do it. And the reason I was going to do it is because it gave me an ROTC scholarship. The reason I needed the ROTC scholarship, and I'm not the type at all for this stuff, but I really wanted to continue to go to music school, a really good jazz school I was going to, believe it or not, called University of Miami. And I'd gone there for a semester on a full tuition scholarship. And as I was there on my full tuition scholarship and everything was cruising along really well, I don't normally drink, but and I wouldn't recommend it, but I had been doing just that. And my roommate, who is a little shorter than I am, was basically attacked by this guy who came down with a fire extinguisher to squirt him in the face. And he did that because this guy who was going to squirt him in the face is very small, but he was there on a wrestling and boxing scholarship. So he was going to find some other little guy and beat the shit out of him. And he found my roommate, and this was what's going to happen. But instead of him beating the shit out of Doug Grober, I gave him a new target. Because as he picked up the fire extinguisher, I said some smart-ass thing that made everyone laugh at him. I can't remember what it was anymore because all I saw was fists after that. So he was beating the shit out of me, and I was trying to take a swing, thinking that's what you should do. I should hit this guy back. And I just found myself in a hospital in the middle of the night, and my roommate was sitting with me, and I had all these stitches in my face, in my nose, and here. And I asked my roommate, because I'd also broken my hand. And I said, you know, at least I hit him one time. I broke my hand. No, you hit the wall. So hit the wall, broke my hand. Got delivered. This is very uncharacteristic for me as well. I don't normally ride the back of police cars. But I was delivered to my big test in a police car. I failed the test, which meant I lost my scholarship. And I threw my drums into the lake. All this is true. And then I went to bag groceries. So when I was sitting in my room listening to this Elvis Costello record, I was thinking, wow, you know, I think I'm going to... So I told my father, opened the door and said, Papa, I think I might join the Army. You're fucking high. How did he know? Parents know things. Anyway, so I went through this. So this is where the song came from. I joined a Christian band called Almost Home. There was a kind of cookie called Almost Home Cookies, and the guy in the band, he threw cookies out to the audience. When there was an audience, it was fucking terrible. Okay, all right, so that's the story. So basically what I'm doing here is I'm telling you the story. Now I'm going to make it rhyme and put some chords to it, and it'll make sense then. Well, I thought about the Army, that's inside your fucking eye, and I thought...
Got a try.
On all this shit back here. Ryan Lerman on the 4-string bass guitar. Andrew Higley on all that shit back there. As I'm in a storytelling mood tonight, I will tell you that this song was written. It was a lot written about this song because this was the beginning of my band's career, and people tend to. I'll tell you one thing, that when I came to the UK for the first time, I opened up an NME because I'd never heard of the NME, and we were getting ready to have a really big interview with NME and be put on the front of it and everything. And it was Oasis. So I'm on the way to it, and I'm reading it going, God, this is really weird journalism. I mean, it's really dramatic. And then they had this big quote, and it was one of the Gallagher brothers said, "If you don't like our music, then you're shit." I thought, wow, this is really a different kind of country. I like this place. This is good. So we're sitting in the interview, and I thought, I wonder if I said that, if they would put that in the quotes. So in the middle, I said to the guy, "You know, if you don't like our music, then you're shit." He looked kind of taken aback. What a weird thing to say. It's in your magazine. And then they put it in big quotes. So that's really, I got to say it too. And they said, I don't care how tall I am. I happen to be about 5'10". That's sort of average-ish. You know, it's a couple inches below 6 feet. It's just average. But because we made this next song, everyone thinks I'm like 5 feet tall or some kind of fucking troll or something. Like, then they'll meet me, and girls will come up and say, "Yeah, you're really short," and they'll be like this. I go, "Well, I'm fucking taller than you," and they go, "Oh, look, who are the same height?" But it's just because the power of suggestion. So when you write songs, ladies and gentlemen, and your career's coming up, remember that you'll be branded by the things that you say, even if you made it up. So this song, I woke up in the morning, and I had the line that I was 47 inches tall, and I didn't really even know how tall that was in my sleep. As it turns out, it's pretty short. For the record, the rest of the band are all over 6 feet tall. They're pretty tall. Well, Ryan, you're not. Ryan and I aren't as tall as the rest of you, but Sam's really tall. How tall are you? 6'2". You're 6'2". And weighing in the corner, Andrew Higley at
6'2".
Fuck. How tall are you? How tall are y'all?